Pastry. If that word sends shivers up your spine, you are not the only one. Shortcrust pastry can be really difficult, but not anymore. In today's video, I am going to share with you some foolproof tips to make sure that you get amazing flaky and buttery shortcrust pastry every single time, whether it is a sweet or a savory bake. If you do like today's video, please don't forget to give it a big thumbs up. Please don't forget to hit subscribe, and let's get into the tips. First rule of pastry is cold, cold, cold. I often say the key word is cold. If you let your dough heat up too quickly or too much when you're working with pastry dough, you end up with a really heavy, greasy, and thick pastry, which is not what we're going for when we are looking for a lovely short crust. So some ways that we can avoid heating up our pastry too much is to firstly get organized. Make sure that you have all your utensils laid out. This will mean that you can work as quickly as possible, because the longer that you work with pastry, the longer it is in your kitchen, the more chance it has to warm up and become that greasy, thick, heavy pastry. Make sure that your butter is chilled until the very last second that you need to use it. So this could mean that you cube your butter in advance and then you pop it back into the fridge. Use ice water if possible. So pop a couple of ice cubes in a glass, let it sit there and get really cold. Pastry loves cold liquid. People tend to make the mistake of taking their butter out of the fridge and cubing it there and then. And by that stage, the heat of your hands, the heat of the room has already started to melt your butter, depending on where you live, of course. If you have particularly warm hands, which is not something I do have, I have really, really cold hands, which is great for pastry making. Just wash your hands under a cold tap and that will cool them down, making for perfect pastry conditions. Another thing that I would also say is try not to bake anything the morning that you are making pastry. Next up, you need to be really accurate with the amount of liquid that you add to your pastry. Flour soaks up water really quickly, so it's going to be very easy to actually send your pastry from a lovely flaky crumbly mixture to a soggy mess. It is always easier to start with about 2 to 3 tablespoons of liquid, whether it's water or egg, at the very beginning, and make sure you chop it in really, really well, rather than having to start all over again, because you cannot remove too much liquid once it has been added. But there is a fine balance to reach here. Too little liquid and your pastry will end up looking like the map of Ireland. It's very common to see pastry with very broken edges, and this a lot of the time can be because too little liquid was added and simply your pastry is too short. Now, this is not a problem when it comes to taste or baking, but it can be a problem when you try to roll that pastry dough out. My next tip is to be careful not to overhandle the dough. So we've got to the point where now we know that cold is your pastry's best friend. Adding your hands and working that dough a lot is going to cause the pastry to heat up, again, meaning that we may have a greasy pastry. The pastry dough should come together fairly easily without too much working by just rounding it gently into a ball. You're definitely not going to knead your pastry in the same way that you would knead bread. Once your pastry is shaped into a round, it is time to roll it out. I see this a lot where people fire tons of flour onto their work surface. This does not work. When I say lightly flour your work surface, I mean a light dusting of flour. Because if you add too much, you are imbalancing the recipe that you've just created. It's not going to be that perfect ratio of fat to flour. So lightly sprinkle your work surface, rub it around, and lightly flour your rolling pin as well. This will prevent your pastry dough sticking to the rolling pin, causing any tears. So we're doing really well so far, but you've noticed that your pastry is now stuck to your work surface. And if you're me, you've probably cried. But don't worry, grab your palette knife. It is palette knife to the rescue. Lightly flour your palette knife and just run it under your pastry. It should release it from being stuck to the surface, and you can continue on your merry baking journey, crisis averted. So adding your pastry to your tart tin can be where a lot of people fall down, especially with something like a quiche, where there can be quite a lot of texture on your pastry tart tin. I don't typically grease my tart tins because the high fat content in your pastry dough means that it is really, really unlikely to stick to your tart tin. But if you are worried, it's no harm, just do a really light greasing. Again, we don't want to imbalance the dough. But where a lot of people fall down is they are not careful moving their pastry. If you are not comfortable moving your pastry, just roll it over your rolling pin, lift up and roll out, just like I am doing here. This can be a really good option if your pastry dough is quite soft. If you live somewhere where it is just really, really impossible to keep your pastry super, super chill until the very last second. And it's really important to be super gentle when you're trying to work your pastry into your tin. You don't want to stretch the dough causing any tears or holes. So just take a little bit of that off-cut pastry so that your fingers are not coming into contact with the dough. Again, making sure that we can keep it chill and just work it gently into each divot and each little crook of your tin. Just gently hold the pastry on the edge as you're working it into the tin and push in lightly. Naturally, at this point, you should have some overhanging dough hanging over the edges of your tart tin, which is perfectly fine. That's exactly where we want to be. So always roll out slightly larger than the tart tin that you want to use. So now what we want to do is rest our pastry in the fridge for at least an hour. Sometimes I even rest my pastry overnight. In fact, most of the time I do this. Resting your pastry not only allows the butter to firm back up, but it also allows the gluten to relax in your pastry dough. Gluten is a protein that when worked causes the pastry to be very elastic. But what we want is that gluten to relax back down so that we don't get any shrinkage in the oven. If you don't chill your pastry and allow that gluten time to relax, you probably will end up with a pastry that looks perfect going in the oven, but by the time it comes out, it has shrunk back massively to the point that you may not even be able to fill your tart with any filling. So depending on the method that I'm using, it is quite common to bake a pastry blind. And the way that we do this is we firstly prick the base of the pastry as this allows any air to escape that might be trapped. You add a layer of parchment paper and ceramic baking beans to weigh down the pastry case. Because if you don't weigh down a pastry case when you bake it blind, i.e. you bake it without any filling, you can end up with a pastry that rises in the center and is very uneven and difficult to fill. So you would bake your pastry blind for 10 minutes, usually with the beans in, depending on the recipe, at quite a high temperature, then removing the beans and baking it for another 10 minutes once you're sure that your pastry is not going to bubble up in the center. It really does depend on the recipe, so if your recipe calls for baking blind, please don't skip this step, you will regret it. Your pastry case basically won't be able to support the filling and it will all just fall apart into a giant, soggy, gelatinous mess. And my last tip for foolproof pastry is to choose your method carefully. Depending on your level of skill, the time that you have allocated to making your pastry, and also the heat and conditions of your home. So by this I mean whether you're going to use the rubbing in method or you're going to use a food processor. Rubbing in is a lot more time consuming and it involves physically rubbing in the butter into the flour using your fingertips. But what you want to do is rub in until your mixture resembles sandy fine breadcrumbs and you know that your pastry is then ready to add your liquid. Working with a food processor can speed things up tenfold. Really, it has saved me so much time. But you do have to be quite careful that you don't overmix your flour and butter because you can end up, as I said, not adding enough liquid because you've overmixed it and it has already become homogeneous, meaning that your pastry will be very, very short. So just stop when it starts to resemble fine breadcrumbs. Just use the pulse button maybe 10 to 15 times and then check to see how your mixture is coming along. And there we have it, folks. If you follow these tips carefully and you practice and have patience, you will absolutely become the master of amazing short crust pastry. If you have any of your own foolproof pastry tips that I haven't mentioned here, leave them in the comments section down below. And if you liked today's video, please don't forget to give it a big thumbs up. Please don't forget to hit subscribe. And I can't wait to see you back on my channel for my next video. Bye.